So much of our life is looking back and realizing that that challenge, whether it be running 2 miles, 4 miles, 6 miles, whether it be graduate school but needing an extra year, or students all the time fail out of a nursing program, and I will have to hold that space for them to help them realize that 5 years is not going to end them instead of 4 years. So we have to really know these lessons for ourselves so that we can show them for our students. Because we can talk and talk and talk and talk and talk and talk, but until we are resilient, until we believe that what they are being challenged by is worth it, then they're not going to believe us. So let's take a moment with, I chose green, I see it was a popular color, green for growth. And on the first two cells on the 2x3 matrix in front of you, if this is for you to keep, so write down what you want, be prepared to share if you want. If you can answer the top two, so what challenges in your life are overwhelming? Not enough time, not enough money. What is it? And then ask somebody to beside you to take your sheet and reframe it for you. So whatever your challenge is, that they're gonna reframe it. Go Essex, I like the shirts, that's awesome. That's team. So ask someone beside you to reframe it in a way that is an opportunity for growth. So if you have not enough money, have you ever considered how you're spending your money? Blame your kids, blame your wife, take control. So three things on each side. So do what you see as a challenge and then pass it over to somebody else and ask them to reframe it. Part of challenge and resilience is trusting people to sometimes know what's best for you when you don't know what's best for you. We're always asking our students to listen to us. How much do we listen to other people? How often do people spend money hiring a psychologist and only wanting validation for bad behavior instead of wanting to change, wanting to actually accept the challenge, own the challenge? So we'll spend a couple minutes on that, and then we'll look for some answers. So you're stuck. Stuff stresses you out. Have you ever thought about it? Going from a challenge to an opportunity is being willing to give up the challenge. Often the challenges in front of us, you have to ask yourself, was that the same challenge that was there 10 years ago? How much of that challenge has to do with your identity? Do you need the stuff, or do you need the stuff to complain about? Do you need the not having enough time as an excuse not to be with people that you really don't want to be with? Yeah, they're saying the same thing about you. Works both ways. I've heard both sides of the couch. Or maybe you just want to be with some one person and don't have time for others. So that's how we say that we're busy. So how many of you put your hand up had too busy, not enough time? Too busy, not enough time. Okay, let's work with that one. What would be a way of reframing too busy, not enough time? How is that an opportunity? How is that an opportunity? I'm going to pose one thing. How many of you that put too busy, not enough time, get bored easily? Put your hand up. Yeah, more than that. Okay, so if you had your hand up for too busy, not enough time, I'd like to see you put your hand up and I'll come around and see what the solution from your neighbor was for that. Okay? What would be a solution to too busy, not enough time? Why is it so hard? Ask yourself. Put your hand up if that was one of your answers, too busy, not enough time. Okay? Okay? So why is it so hard to slow down?
You feel like you have to accomplish everything in that time frame.
So, and what if you don't?
It piles up the next day with the next amount.
So there's always going to be a pile.
Yes.
What about taking a day off from the pile?
No can do.
So you say. I'll let you meditate on that. Think about that. Can't solve all the problems here, but really think about it. Take a day off from the pile. And take a day for you. Okay, I'm going to move to the next one because we... Okay, so I'm going to move through and talk about reframing stress and challenge and how we need stress. There are two kinds of stress, really. There's a stress that keeps you in the same place. Bad relationships, bad choices, bad places, whatever it is. And then there's a kind of stress that you actually need, like an adrenaline charge, to get you to the next level. So how many sports fanatics do we have in here? You've heard of the term in the zone, flow. So in sports, you have to warm up before you can play a good game. For me to do a presentation, I have to be nervous. I accept it. I think Ange was nervous last night, probably today a little bit. It's looking at that stress and realizing that our bodies were built for stress. That if you reframe it and you look at it in a positive way, instead of narrowing your focus, it actually increases your focus. You've seen the movie Limitless, where they took a pill, where that particular, I can't remember the actor, took a pill to get into the zone. And it's the idea that anxiety is too much stress with not enough skills. So it's about, this is our role as an educator. When a student is in a certain zone, it's because their skill level doesn't match their challenge level. And so we have to work hard to get into the zone. And it, you can't just show up there, that it's over time. So as I mentioned earlier, our job is to make it challenging for our students. And you agree with that, I know that, that's student success. But you can't talk about student success without talking about student stress, yourself included. That I'll say to students, what if this exam was worth 0% instead of 50? The nursing final was worth 50%. They prepared, they studied, they were nervous, they were anxious, but it focused them and it motivated them. Stress can motivate. It's all about framing for a purpose. And there's a whole body of research, if you're interested, on flow and flow psychology. And then you'd be familiar with this, the growth mindset. And it's the idea that when somebody has more of a growth mindset, when they experience a challenge, and I think about how many exams I've failed in my lifetime, multiples. The more successful you are, which this room is filled with successful people, the more exams that you failed. But what makes a difference is you don't say, yet, it's over. You say, not yet. And you're gonna do it again. So I'll share with students once again, particular exams that I don't necessarily want to have on camera right now that I failed. And then I'll just give a second and then I'll say, yes, and I have a PhD. So I failed, I did all those things and I still achieved. And it really shapes us for life. I don't want to crumble when things get challenging. I might crumble in the moment, but big picture, I overcome it. And we want that for our students too. Because when we talk about resilience, it's more important than ever now. And I know that you have a directive from your school board that's an achievement plan and a well-being plan. And that the success team is built into that. And it's on the website. Because we can't have achievement without well-being. And well-being is about resilience. And this is a life skill that's more important than ever because things are moving so fast. The way that we are brought up, back to nature, it really doesn't look like it exists like it used to. So we have to model for our students that it's okay to fail, that we create a safe, unconditional space for them, and that you're proud of them, not that they failed, that they responded with dignity to the failure. Because that's life. Things don't just happen. They're not just handed to you. Even though at Starbucks the other day, I heard, and now you can tell a lot about me, Starbucks versus Tim Hortons. I do not discriminate. But I was at Starbucks the other day, and a 12-year-old there was there with his credit card. There was a tap credit card. And I remember him saying to his dad, oh, it's not nice. I just tapped, and I thought, oh, my God. I'm, like, thanking every strict thing that my parents ever did with me. And my point is that life should be hard when we're young so that we can build those muscles so that when we grow up, when we're older, that we're capable. And that's part of it. So I really, once again, I really appreciate the work that you do as educators. I mean, it's everything. So the first thing that we want to do, and we've talked about it a little bit, is we want to accept the challenge. I talk to my students, we're academic warriors. I play the song, The Fighter, because we are building muscles in our brain that will make the difference between a life of challenge long-term and one of thriving. Surviving to thriving. And as you can see right here, and I've quoted the research, is that the way we look at a stressful event, as I mentioned, is everything. Because you are all witnessing me very differently. Whether you are at the back of the room, the front of the room, go Essex with your shirts on, whatever it is, the point is that perception is not reality. And that's why you can have 100 people witness a tragic event and only 50 of them be impacted on them. So what we need to do as educators is we need to help with the filter of perception. So every chance I get, I will reframe in the classroom for my students so that it starts to become their internal dialogue. Because another downfall of all this technology is that we have so much time to think. Space to think. And most people don't go to pleasant places when they're thinking. Their minds are wandering to places of danger. And so students have to be able to manage their thoughts more than we ever did, more than ever. So they did a recent study and they had, say, 1,000 participants were texted throughout the day and were asked what were they doing. And on a scale of 1 to 5, if they were enjoying it, 5 being enjoyment. And the third thing that was asked is your mind wandering or not? And what they found, and I hope you're with me right here, right now, is that your enjoyment throughout the day has nothing to do with what you're doing. It's whether you're in the moment and thinking about what you're actually doing. So if you're brushing your teeth and looking in the mirror and saying, it's gonna be a great day, then you're having fun in that moment. And you might be at a dinner on Erie Street, great food, but you don't like the person you're with. You're thinking about brushing your teeth. So when they text you that in that moment, your happiness is dependent on being in the moment. We're going to talk about that today. How that's one thing that we always have control of us over is the moment. And humor is amazing. Yeah, a couple people are falling asleep. That's okay. I know what time of the day it is. Humor always brings us back to the moment. I won't call him out. He's over there. Okay. So I had the opportunity, a little screen grab, to be on the Stephen and Chris show about 5 years ago and talk about change, because most people don't own change. Most people run from change. And I used the 3 C's of stress hardiness to talk about fear, our fear of change. We actually spend more time fearing the fear than we do the fear of change. And so this is just the idea that I was talking about, that you have to own it. You're getting older. Accept it. Just quit fighting it. I will know at 50 if you've had past plastic surgery. It's evident. You can't wear your daughter's 16-year-old jeans and be 16. You got to own it. The next is control. We have 2 variables left. So how much do you feel that you can influence events in your life? So let's go to the next quadrant. This C, there's 3 C's, okay? You might enjoy wearing your jeans, that's okay. That's cute. So how many, if you look on the next question is, where do you feel most capable in your life? So if you think about fitness, if you think about home, if you think about teaching, if you think about anything, money, if you think about design, list the areas of your life on that sheet of paper that you feel most capable. So list the top, say the top 5. Okay, take three. I'm an optimist. One if you need to. You can draw a picture if you want. Okay, so start with that. We'll not fill out the other one for a minute. So what they found with the original study of hardiness with the Bell employees, the one-third that actually did better after the major downsizing, is the second variable was control. If they felt in control of a particular part of their work or life, then they were less likely to be affected by the stress. So think about our students. You know, if they're feeling out of control because of what's happening in their family life, you know, what can you do in the classroom or in the school to make them feel that they matter, that they have an influence? So whether it be doing reading exercises with the JKSK, whether it be, I mean, it was a big deal when I was in school to be in charge of the chalk and taking down the chalkboard. So if it, maybe it's helping out with the team shirts at Essex, the red shirts at the back. So where, if they feel important and if they feel they can influence, so I know for sure at my work that what happens in my classroom, you know the rest of that sentence. So whatever happens in my classroom is within my control. And especially what kind of mood I'm in my classroom. My students count on coming to my room, my mood being consistent, my mood being predictable, and knowing that they're gonna be welcomed. Now, when we talk about strength finders in a second, one of my strengths is, surprise, surprise, positivity. So that's one of my strengths, and I'm a connector. And each and every one of you have different strengths that you can incorporate, and you are incorporating in the classroom. When I feel in control, and I might just be in control of one thing, then it, my students feel it. So everything that we talk about student stress really should be our stress, how we manage it, how we frame it, because that's what matters most. So strengths, how I asked you in terms of what you feel most capable of, and what you feel most capable of might not even be in the classroom. Maybe you've lost your interest in teaching, but you don't even want to talk about it because it pays your mortgage, okay? But what happens is if you focus on, yeah, the dirty little secret, not happening in this room, that if you focus on what you're good at, for example, if you look at a grocery store, and maybe, you know, a lot of my students are working, perhaps at Zehrs to pay the bills for school, but they're not into it because they think, oh, I should be a nurse already, I'll remind them of how many ways they can act with the characteristics of a nurse, altruistic, connected, meaningful, helping out, all those things. And then all of a sudden, that will start to have more value and influence at work. When we think about control, we think big, but it's really small. And it's the little things that we do that get big. That it's one student at a time. Because I think about how many students, some of my classes are huge, that get lost in the class. And that I have to make sure that I treat my students equally because every one of them matters. Even if they don't come to the front of the room after class, even if I can't, you know, they don't stick out, that I have to make sure that they know that they all matter because what they do matters. And this is one of the reasons that we have such a huge social media culture. Because we have, unfortunately, a lot of students that are left behind in their own homes, and so the only place that they can find out and feel that they matter is online. But what happens is that you end up having twice the stress. And this includes you and your Facebook. Because you are carrying two personas and two lives. And then at some point, one becomes just too much work for the other. But back to strengths and control, is asking yourself, where do you feel most capable? And looking for our students in terms of where they feel most capable. And that positive emotions, this is called, the second one's the broaden and build theory of positive emotions and psychology, is that it's not just about feeling good, it's that if you feel joy, happiness, contentment, it actually broadens you in terms of how you act and think. So if you go back to Maslow's hierarchy of needs, emotions were underneath esteem, We can't think straight, any one of us in this room, until our emotions are taken care of. So if we're feeling a sense of persecution or fear or negativity, then we're not able to focus for extended periods of time. And so that's another reason why I know from my personal mission as a professor that the classroom is a positive, uplifting place that we spend probably, if we have a three-hour class, the first 10 minutes just getting everybody relaxed, ready to learn, and we can learn twice as much in half the time because they're focused. No phones, no anything in there. I will walk them to the Tim Hortons down the hall, but I have to tell you, when someone feels connected to their teacher, when you're with them and you make it meaningful, they don't want to be on their phones. Phones are a poor substitute for the real thing. This is why strengths are important in acknowledging them. Because if we're only teaching certain skills that are not your strengths, then you don't realize what a genius you are. So when I teach about multiple intelligence, I remind you and my students, because I do teach intelligence and test it for a living, is that every single person in this room, every single person in this room is a genius at something. Maybe everything, but at least one thing. So myself personally, my strengths are interpersonal and intrapersonal and definitely linguistic. At a young age, my father said, Andrea, whatever you do, make sure you get paid to talk. And your parents may have said the same thing to you. So I'll also tell my students that there's not one lazy person in this room, in my classroom. They just haven't found what makes their heart sing. And once we find out what makes our heart sing, there's no stopping us. And I have to tell you, I learned the most from my tech teachers at the Teachers College when I worked with Vicki Houston, because they would tell me all these stories about how they were left behind for so many years from the academic side until they really found the technology that brought out the best in them. And so that's important to remember too. And we need to ask that question of our students. Another reason that control and focusing on what works is so important is that our brains are wired that the more that we repeat a story, whether it be positive or negative, the more it becomes entrenched in our neural network. So for example, if I'm doing therapy, 20% of the time I'll focus on the client's story from the past, and the 80% of the time I'll focus on the solution. So I will acknowledge, I'll respect, but I won't entrench it over and over and over. So for some of us, when we complain and we blame, it feels good at the time, but what ends up happening is because neurons that fire together, wire together, meaning that the neural networks get stronger, when something bad happens, that negative thought will come more quickly than a positive solution. And part of control is knowing when to let go. So this is a room filled with helpers, problem solvers. I got that. I'm in charge. You know, it feels good until it hurts. It's like helping till it hurts. So I know we have many guidance counselors in this room that Friday afternoon is the worst time of the day because they're lined up and they need problems solved right there and then. But we have to remember that compassion is something that we have to build up from self-compassion, that you have to take the time for yourself. It's a directive, and you come back giving double. And this goes back to locus of control. There are only so many things outside of you that you can control, and having the courage to recognize that, like, I'll take your lists. It might hurt a little bit as you tell me your challenge that you don't want to give up. There's so many challenges you don't want to give up because it makes you feel in control when you hold on to that challenge. Some of the hardest things to do is say, I can't do it. But you know what? We expect our students to tell us and reach out for help, but we aren't willing to do it for ourselves. So everything that we're asking of our students and our staff, I know we have a lot of administrators in this room, you gotta do it for yourself first. And Trust me, I know compassion fatigue firsthand. What brings you to a profession like psychology and social work, guidance counseling, teaching, is because once again, you were that grade four that would help out everybody in the classroom. Now, I remember before they had the before and after shows, I would go into my friend's bedroom and do it over. I mean, you name it, I did it. And it's exciting, but at the end of the day, you got to take the oxygen for yourself first. There's no question. So on that sheet of paper, if you want to add a couple things that you know you need to let go of, even one thing, and you might go at it many, many times. So what are some things that you would like to let go? What would you like to let go, Mr. Principal?
Ironically enough, it's the laundry.
The laundry. How old are your kids?
12, 10, and 7.
And why aren't they doing their own laundry?
They do sometimes.
Okay. So whose laundry are you talking about, your wife's?
Primarily, yes.
So should we schedule an intervention?
I'm not going to say anything else because she has friends here in the room, so.
I think she used to do the laundry, but this gentleman's so meticulous that she got upset about every time she didn't do it right. Was that part of it?
I've never met you before, have I?
I read people for a living. Thank you for volunteering, though. He's like, oh, I heard that. Defense mechanism. What would you like to let go of? Anybody at this table? Oh, it's got silent. Anybody want to volunteer what they want to let go of? So, okay, we got a... Pardon?
I just put of the things at school that we, like, getting rid of what we can't control after the school hours. Oh. Letting go of after, between the hours of 9 and 3, we help the kids, and after that, we can't control what happens. We can't help control what happens on a lot of levels.
No, we can't. So many of the things that you think that we think we can control, and then you feel guilt. How many of you have guilt on the table because of that, right? How much of the letting go is thoughts? Thoughts. Guilt. Yes. True. Excellent. Thank you for answering. And thank you for not volunteering. Oh. Okay, so we have one C left. And really, this is the most important one of all. This is for our students. This is for ourselves. This is for our community. And it's really feeling that what we do matters. That there's a purpose, that there's a sense of connection, that there's meaning. And so you can see really how the three C's to come together with commitment. So no matter how big or small, like when you go to a restaurant or when you're, for example, use a restaurant, you can tell what kind of success is going to come out of a young person often by how much care they take in the little things. And the interesting thing is relate back to control. We do have control over the little things, but not necessarily the big things. So what is your commitment? Think about when you applied to Teachers College. Why did you want to be a teacher? You know, the irony is, not irony, it's no synchronicity. The book here about why, and I write about why in my book, and I'll be referencing in a second. So ask yourself, why did you choose teaching? Why did you choose marriage? Why did you choose Windsor, Ontario? The interesting thing about Windsor is nobody says they love it, but then again, nobody leaves. I love Windsor. I'm not from here, and one of the reasons I love Windsor is back to I like to talk. No matter where I go in Windsor, there's always someone to talk to. They always talk back to me. Like, there's nothing wrong. I go to London, Toronto, they wonder, who's this stranger? In Windsor, everybody's your friend. So there's such a sense of community. It's a beautiful thing that you might not realize unless you're from here. It's very East Coast in that way, so I really enjoy it. So who are you? How does your identity fit in with your commitment? And so the idea about a commitment, back to marriage, if you're fully committed to that marriage, being a parent, fully committed to being a parent, a teacher, the little things don't bother you so much because you realize there's a bigger picture that's involved. And as I was mentioning earlier, that the really successful people, hello, student success, you wouldn't be here otherwise, you failed. And we need to remind our students that it's part of the process. The thing about failure is when you're in it, it's no fun. We all know that, right? When we're in it, like I mentioned earlier, very similar to stress, thank you, very similar to stress, you think it's gonna go on forever. That you're gonna fail out, that the relationship's over, that you're gonna be have no house, whatever it is. But when we know, and we can help our students understand, that the failure is just part of the fabric of our commitment to our family, a greater family, that's another reason I love Windsor, so many Italians. Thinking about Sunday afternoon at your place, Italian food. I'm not Italian, I married an Italian, for good reason. So anyway, I've just gotta stop, I'll come back to here. So commitment is that if you know what you're aiming for is big, then you're gonna keep going. It's just a blip. And so as educators, we have to be able to remind our students that it's a blip. And what I find what helps is I can model for them that, but if I can find students that are a few years ahead of them to come back and meet with them and even be in the classroom and say, you know, what validate really what I'm saying, because I'm somewhat, in a lot of ways, I'm separate from them, then that helps them get through it. And that video up there just showing so many famous figures and how they ended up where they are. We need to feel that we matter. We need to feel important. So back to about 45 minutes ago when I say to my students that you are the most important part of my day, and I mean it. And the first time I said that, I remember students saying, what'd she do the rest of the day? They are the most important part of my day. Just like being here with you, they light me up. They're my reason, they're my mission. You know, I didn't realize it, as I mentioned before, it's because of my own failures and challenges, layoff or whatever you want to call it, that I ended up where I am. But when they're with me, I want them to feel like there's no other place in the world than with me. I want to hold them in my attention. I want to speak to them like we're in conversation, not in instruction. And I know you do the same. This is a reminder of what you do and how delivery is as important as content. Delivery in a lot of ways is more important than content. Because students know how to read. They need to be motivated and engaged and realize that they're my why. I'm part of their why. And I explain to them that I love teaching so much because I have the opportunity every year, every semester, say by the time I'm finished, you know, maybe 500 students a year, I'm a part of their future, and that feels so big. And sometimes, once again, for student engagement, motivation, in terms of stress, that it's just a blip, because if they feel protected, if they feel safe, and it's a lot of fun, we laugh a lot, it gets a little goofy, I'll confess, and that they're relaxed, then I can slide in the information. And so resilience isn't that bad things don't happen. The worst thing that we could ever do is save our children, ourselves, our students, our adolescents from bad things. They happen, but what are we going to do about it? It's important that we ask these questions. So if you want to work on your sheets just for a couple more minutes, is that I ask big picture, what is your mission? But I'm asking you right now, what is your mission in this moment? If five times a day, brushing your teeth, dinner on Erie Street, movie at Lakeshore, going for a run. Oh, I just talked about my day. So, or whatever it is, what is your mission? Life is really short. And unfortunately, most of us don't realize how short it is until someone we love dies. We can ask that question now in terms of what is your mission? So this is gonna be my last question, and I hope I get some answers from you. That what is your mission right now in this moment? What did you hope to get out of today? For the full day, do you mind?
Well, I think with the full day is just a sense of connecting with the family at schools. in terms of supporting our students. And I think with this particular session, coping with stress and everything, we wear lots of different hats, and how to say no, which is often difficult, but.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, thank you for sharing. And it's true. I know that for a lot of you, you feel more like an ambulance driver, a firefighter, a nurse, and less like an educator because you are putting out a lot of those fires. So this is a great opportunity to connect and be here together. And sometimes it can be that simple. To just be together as educators and realize that you're not in it alone. And that's what commitment's about too. It's having a sense of connection. Go Windsor. I love Windsor. I wasn't born here. I love Windsor. So ask yourself, because when you ask, what is my mission for this moment? Why did I choose education? And maybe education chose you. Maybe you need to recommit to it, like on your 10-year anniversary, you get remarried in Vegas, drive-through. That's what I do with Elvis. Is that it really is our compass. And we need to ground ourselves with these questions. Are you in Vegas right now? Probably sent you to Vegas. I believe so strongly in asking why that I start my textbook with the question. I ask them, why are you studying psychology? You know, why nursing? I had a student at Teachers College say that they had no idea why they were being taught something. And I thought, that's a good point. We don't ask why enough. Why is the beginning of motivation? Why is the beginning of so much? So, as I said, I feel so blessed to be here with you in Windsor and spend this time, hopefully, giving you some tools and know that I put my email on there if I can support you, ask a few questions about this presentation. And I wanted to say thank you. I hope you feel uplifted in some little way.